I'd like to call to order the Bothell City Council special meeting of Tuesday, December 27, 2016. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All council members are present except Mayor Rayum and Councilmember Freed, who are both absent and excused. So looking at the consent agenda, does anyone want to pull anything from the consent agenda? Does anyone have a motion?
Move the recommended action.
Second.
Okay, moved by Councilmember Agnew and seconded by Councilmember Sandberg. Please vote. Motion passes unanimously with Councilmember Freed absent and excused and Mayor Rayum absent and excused. So before we do the public hearing for the comprehensive plan and related code amendments, we need to take a couple minute break so that we can get the two absent council members on the phone. So we'll be right back. Oh, there he is. I was looking for you in the front row.
Good evening. Sorry, it took me a while to get my presentation going. Of course, this is a 2016 plan and code amendments and includes provisions requiring the Fitzgerald 35th Southeast and Canyon Creek 39th Southeast Subarea Plan and Code Amendments, or the North Creek Protection Area, as we're proposing for the new name. It also includes two other areas. One is the West Hill Subarea, and the other is the Downtown Subarea. The West Hill Subarea involves a proposal by the Williamsons to rezone or redesignate a piece of property they have. And of course, the University of Washington Bothell Cascadia campus, there's some expansions going on there. I just kind of wanted to identify that kind of procedurally what occurred was that the University of Washington Bothell and Cascadia College and New Williamson Plan and Code Amendment public hearings were closed, and those were preliminarily approved by the council on December 13th. Primarily, the topic tonight is to talk about the Fitzgerald 35th Southeast and the Canyon Creek 35th Southeast, sometimes called the Fitzgerald area, and the subsequent passage of an ordinance that would adopt the entire suite of 2016 plan and code amendments. That's the primary subject of tonight's hearing. Now, of course, as we know, the mayor, of course, opens the hearing. You get a brief staff presentation. We'll accept public testimony on the Fitzgerald plan and code amendments. Then, of course, we'll hold council deliberations on those items. And we are hoping that tonight we can have a motion and vote to close the public hearing regarding the Fitzgerald plan amendments and code amendments, as well as on a motion to approve the entire 2016 plan and code amendment docket, which basically includes the University of Bothell campus and the Cascadia campus. Now, there were some areas identified by Councilmember Sandberg to me about the findings. And we took a look at those, and I think she's right. We've got some areas where we could probably fix and do a little bit better coordination on it. And so with that, I would ask the council to give staff the ability to do a couple things. One is craft a new finding that would go within each of those individual finding documents that basically said, look, this is part of the 2016 plan and code amendment, and these findings specifically discuss the Williamson, for example, provision. We also want to create a little bit more uniform appearance in the findings. There are some different text format and some sizes that are a little bit different. And we also want to use the same language throughout. There's a couple places that have some different terms for the same thing, you know, kind of like that one voice style. So we'd ask to have us do some of these little minor amendments to the proposed findings. Now with that, I think I'll close out my comments because I know we probably have a lot of public testimony to get through, as well as some council discussions. And of course, we do have a lot of additional information we can provide if we have to, you know, maps and things of that nature. I think I'll close it with that, unless Tom wanted to say anything additionally. Thank you.
Thanks, Bruce. Just a few comments about the Fitzgerald process, and I won't take too much of the council's time, but it's been a long journey, and this long journey has incorporated enhanced public involvement, much more than the average city would incorporate. But it's such an important item. It speaks well for Bothell's process. There were regular policy check-ins and updates with City Council during the planning process and planning period, and a comprehensive review of best available science, multiple reviews of proposed code amendments with City Council. We not only addressed policy forks in the road, but we also brought alternative language to the City Council and to the public for commentary before we got to this point. So the guiding light behind all of this is the Growth Management Act and its 13 state mandated planning goals. And it's not an easy job for a City Council to take those 13 goals and balance those with these land use cases, land use decisions that you're obligated to make. And as you do that, all of the goals are important, but there are some goals that are more applicable to this planning effort than others. And I would point the council's attention to number one, which is encourage growth in urban growth areas. And I passed out a one page of the planning goals that are in your packet if you wish to review them. Number six, which is to protect property rights from arbitrary and discriminatory actions and shall not take private land without just compensation. Balancing those with retaining open space and conserving fish and wildlife habitat, that's number nine. And number 10, protect the environment, air quality and water quality. Those goals are consistent. They started with the Act 25 years ago, and it doesn't get any easier. There's no roadmap for you to follow. It's up to the local jurisdictions to sort through those goals and balance the policies. And as we do that, I think it's important to identify that it's not a perfect world, and it won't be a perfect solution. There'll always be some give and take and struggle as those goals are balanced throughout the planning process. Going forward, the steps for implementation will include some of the following four steps, and that will be that as proposed development comes forward, they must meet the State Environmental Policy Act. That's been consistent throughout all of the time period for the Growth Management Act, and will continue with further development. Second, the proposed development must comply with the Critical Area Code of Bothell, and that's codified in our environmental section. Parametrics did review that, and they've identified that it's a strong code for the city and meets the critical areas requirements. Then third, the proposed development must meet the base zoning and standards within that zoning districts that are established for these areas. And they'll be reviewed against those standards embedded within the zoning code. And finally, for the areas that are in the NCPA, the NCPA will have to meet an additional test through those sub-area zoning regulations. And it's important to identify that those sub-area regulations are embedded in zoning, not the critical areas ordinance. They're not subsets of the critical area ordinance. They are embedded within the zoning code itself and founded based on implementation of the comprehensive plan policies. So this is at the end of that journey, and it's been a good process, and it's one where no party who's been involved got everything they wanted out of it. And I think that identifies the compromises and the balances that are exhibited with the final draft before you tonight. It has give and take in those areas of those goals that we've identified from the planning policies. One item out of those policies I would like to note at the end is also policy 11. And policy 11 is enhanced, is public engagement, citizen participation and coordination. And with this process, that has been significantly enhanced. The interaction between all of the parties involved has has been extraordinary for a subarea process such as the Fitzgerald area. So moving forward, the final draft that has been prepared, I'd like to just summarize. Paul Fent and Ben Burke with Parametrics have prepared the technical memorandum and have conducted the research on best available science. I want to thank Paul Byrne and Scott Massal for the legal guidance throughout the process, and certainly, last but not least, Bruce Blackburn for all his technical expertise in pulling this all together. So I think, summing up, this has been a fantastic planning process, and we've come to a good summary, a good conclusion of what the council has asked of the staff and the citizens who have been involved in that process. So, thanks.
So now is the time for public testimony, but I don't have any sign-up sheets. Does anyone in the audience want to speak? Ann Eger? I don't have the little text that Andy reads about three, I'm sure you know the drill, 3 minutes and so on.
Good evening, Council. I just handed to the clerk a copy of Suzanne Burnell's testimony that she sent to you earlier, so that it is in the record, as well as the testimony that I sent to you this afternoon, and I also entered a copy into the record, and I brought an extra copy for you. I'm just going to summarize a few of the points in my testimony. They deal primarily with the best available science and primarily with that of Ben Berkey. As I reviewed the final memorandum from Mr. Berkey, dated December the 8th, I noted that he highlighted the fact that the Pentec, the Stewart and Associates, and the Parametrics report of 2006 do not represent the level of unique and outstanding habitat value that the best available science represented a decade ago. And he repeats this in several different parts. And again, he says the findings that the critical areas are either uniquely superior or pristine are substantively more sensitive than other critical areas. So I looked at all of these reports, and not one of them made that claim in any place in their report. So I view Mr. Berkey's statements as deliberately misleading, without any technical substantiation, and completely inappropriate as a piece of scientific evidence. Furthermore, I looked through each of these, and in particular, I point out the Pentec report, where in that report, in their findings, they specifically talk about how they used a particular Coordian methodology for the wetlands, and that they noted this in their report, that it would soon be replaced by another type of delineation system, the Western Washington Wetlands, so Wetlands Rating System, and they appropriately noted this. Then in a separate piece, the parametrics reported on page 310 in the attachments that the water qualities of Palm and Coal Creek were actually warmer than North Creek. And I looked at the technical data that he referenced, the 2015 report, and there is nothing in that report that even vaguely substantiates the statement that he made regarding water temperature. In fact, they don't even talk about it. So I concluded that, how are we doing? Things are buzzing.
We don't know. Could you wrap up?
I'm wrapping up. Things just keep buzzing.
I apologize. We don't know what's going on.
Okay. So so I just point out in my memo both of these errors by Mr. Berkey's technical memorandum, and that these were obviously used by the city staff to draft the new policies for the Fitzgerald plan and the implementing code. And I will not repeat the information I gave in my memo regarding the public hearing tonight, but I hope that you will think very carefully about the lack of best available science for the changes that you may be proposing. Thank you. Do you have any questions?
Thank you. Does anyone else wish to speak? Okay. Please identify yourself at the podium.
Yes, Andrea Perry. I'm not going to really say very much tonight, except that I would like to say, in my opinion, the public process has not been as grand as was described by staff. I think that there have been a number of issues with it. And in that case, I want to ask you about the final exhibit list. I noticed in your packet that you received this past Friday that it's page 72 of your packet on page 4, number 5. It refers you to the Fitzgerald website if you want to have a look at the exhibit list. But when I go to that page, I don't see it anywhere. I think that part of it is in one agenda packet, but I can't remember exactly which one it is. But I don't think it's a full exhibit list because it was updated in some other packet. But what I'm trying to point out is that if you're going to have a website like this that you're going to tell people
Deputy Mayor, I have lost audio. I cannot hear anything that's being said.
Okay, hold on.
This is Andy Williams.
He can't hear anything. Can you hear it now?
I can hear you now, yes.
Okay.
I lost communication when Ann Agard was giving her testimony. I keep hearing beeps, though. I think people are calling in, perhaps. Maybe that's what's going on. They're not muting their phone.
Oh, I see. So anyone online right now needs to mute their phones, please, unless you're speaking. So do we know, do we have Councilmember Freed on?
I heard a beep went up during live, I don't know.
But we, Councilmember Freed, are you there? I think Acting City Manager Mr. Trodson's on the line though, so that might be part of it. Okay. Okay. Okay, well let's... Let's hope we can survive this. can we have the speaker continue and give her some extra time? Okay. Apologies.
Okay.
Technology.
My point is that in front of you tonight, you should have, you as a council should have a completed exhibit list. The public doesn't have that. We should have it. But you absolutely, before you vote on anything, sign anything, you should be able to see the complete exhibit list. And hopefully you took that into account when you were reading this past weekend. The other thing I want to point out is that on that website, it has a 12.6 version of the draft code, so that if you were a member of the public and you were looking for it, that's what you would go to. That is absolutely not the 12.6 agenda packet version that you receive. They're completely different. So, you know, as far as this being a great public process, really, you don't know which document is the final one. They're both dated the same. They're absolutely different. And when you go to the facts, findings, and conclusions and try to find it, you cannot find it. So I am asking you to put together a complete exhibit list, everything, so that the public can go and take a look at it. And I really think that that is just one point about how bad this public process has been. I would say that you gave some effort to it, but I do not think that it was well coordinated. And the fact that you're having opening a hearing tonight and closing it on the same night and taking it a vote without thinking through the information that you've received over the weekend from citizens, it's not a good public process. So I just want to go on record to say I do not agree with staff. I do not think that this has been a good public process.
Would anyone else like to speak? Please come to the podium. State your name.
Kai Nelson. I wasn't planning to speak, but after listening to that, I will. Thank you, City Council, for all of your hard work. We need to start with that and staff. I mean, this has been what seems like a never-ending topic. I truly hope that you keep your promises of getting this done tonight. I've heard some say that this is the sixth meeting, seventh meeting, eighth meeting. Unfortunately, that's not true. I don't recall how many meetings have actually occurred, but I can say that I personally have been coming to these council meetings for this topic for 11 years. 11. I know others have been asking the council for zoning for almost 20 years now. To say this has been mishandled over the years is a complete understatement. This said, the current staff and council have done so much, and I thank you. However, I am disappointed with specific members of former staff, former council, and with SAVE. Seems quite hypocritical to say that it's fine to put a major five-lane road through this critical species habitat, but then those same people are still fighting and suing the city over what's left of 55 acres, originally set at 5400A, now down to 18 buildable acres. This area is on a hill, is not a wetland, could be paved over and not have any significance on the streams. Our mayor, who's a water quality expert, said this. It is very close to the colleges, bus lanes, business parks, and to downtown Bothell. How many tax dollars has this cost us? How much time and effort have gone into this one topic over the last 20 years? For that matter, over the last year. Staff time, council time, citizen time, developer time, doing three separate paid mediation sessions. If I hear from members of SAVE, again, that there has not been enough public comment or opportunity to have a voice, those folks need to be truly evaluated for sanity.
Would anyone else like to speak? Okay, with that, let's start council deliberations. Would anyone like to speak first? Councilmember Sandberg, thank you.
Okay, so what I did is I, like I did the last time we talked about this, which is on the 13th, is provided you the staff language and what my thought process was and what the changes, what change I would like to see. So when you look at these pages, remember that most of the text is all of the staff language so that you have the full context, not like I'm just giving you a bit and you don't understand where it's at. So I've numbered them 1, through 7, and there actually is 8, which is a little typo. With that, I will, actually, before I go into that, I just wanted to ask Bruce, because we had talked about, or we had emailed about making the findings and actions, findings, conclusions, and actions more parallel. And I heard you said you were going to make those changes. So are we going to have 3 separate findings? So one for Williamson, one for the college campus, and one for Fitzgerald. And then they will each have statements in there about them being part of the one-year major update? Or are you going to also add in some kind of umbrella finding document that comprises all 3?
They're going to remain separate. That's probably the best thing to do now, because they have been acted upon separately. And okay. They all, each one of those has an individual actions. The idea behind it is to insert one paragraph or finding within each of those findings that makes them identify that they are kind of an umbrella action.
So our agenda packet tonight has sort of the umbrella document. That is going to go away, and the important parts of that will be inserted into each individual findings where appropriate.
Yeah, actually, the document you have tonight is probably closer to what's actually going to get in the final. It's going to be pretty minimal. The changes we have to make.
Okay. And then in response to what we've gotten in public testimony, I can understand your frustration that things might not be updated on the website. I can see that the latest agenda packet on the Fitzgerald page is dated December 6th, and there should be one that's dated December 13th, and then today. But I feel as though I have been able to review the entire record. So I feel as though I am making a decision based on the entire record. And then I appreciate the comments that we received about concerns about the best available science studies, and I've taken them under consideration, and I think maybe in part of the questions that I'm bringing forward sort of addresses some of the things that have been brought up in those 2 exhibits. Okay, so with that, on page 78 of this week's agenda packet, there is this finding, and I'm sorry I didn't see it the last time. It's finding number 14, and it reads, testimony and soil excavation descriptions provided by the public indicate that near surface groundwater is not prevalent in upland areas underlain by glacial till. And I am recommending that we remove that bullet, because on page 83, we have the figure that shows that there's 16 test pits with groundwater from 3 to 31 feet. So I don't think we can have a finding that says there is no near surface groundwater when we have a figure that says there is. And I don't think that materially affects any of the other findings or the code language. I just think it's an inaccurate statement. And so maybe if staff wants to comment on that. How is this statement, finding number 14, consistent with the figure on page 83, which has all the test pits?
Well, I think the findings are yours. They belong to the council. And there may be opinions, there may be 7 opinions on, or 6, 5 and 1 online, of what, how you would like to draft the groundwater issue. Please edit that to suit your understanding of the record as you see fit. That was Parametric's summary conclusion. So it's up to you if you'd like to modify it.
Okay. Well, for council, I would recommend removing that language, and I think that the figure on page 83 stands for itself, and the verbiage in that finding for the figure on page 83 stands for itself. So
Do you want to, so should we address each of your comments individually?
Well, we can go through them cumulatively, and then you can decide, or we can do them one by one. It doesn't matter to me.
Anyone have a preference? Okay. Why don't we just go through each issue and weigh in?
Okay.
Who would like to weigh in next? Is it, I mean, on this specific issue? Yeah, on this specific.
I'm in support of removing the language.
I don't know if we have to remove it. We just have to make it accurate.
I don't support removing it. I think that this is basically something that was submitted to the record, and it just indicates, this finding indicates it was submitted to the record. I think that we need to, if we're going to be transparent, we need to have everything that was submitted into the record be part of the record, not just pick and choose which ones satisfy our particular needs.
Mayor Rain, would you like to weigh in?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I don't have it in front of me. Could you read what finding number 14 is?
Yes, testimony and soil excavation descriptions provided by the public indicate that near-surface groundwater is not prevalent in upland areas underlain by glacial till. And Councilmember Sandberg is suggesting we remove that, since there's no definition of near-surface groundwater, and the figure shows groundwater at depths from 3 to 31 feet.
I think we should leave it in because the water that we're talking about, by definition, is called airflow, and it's shallow. It's on top of glacial till, and it comes out of the ground where it comes out. So I think it makes sense to leave it in.
Okay. So I'm for leaving it in as well. So I think that's 3-3 unless. Councilmember Agnew, you were kind of looking for accuracy.
We can leave it in.
Okay.
Okay, so item number 2, this is on page 86 and 87 of the agenda packet. It's the towards the end of finding 23, and this relates to the statement, it's the comprehensive plan policy, land use G10, to protect the property rights of landowners from arbitrary and discriminatory actions. So towards the end there, if you read the strikeout language, it says, however, it is also appropriate to recognize the impact these regulations and the downzoning of these lands have had and will continue to have upon the property owners. And I think it's misleading to say that we are downzoning the property. I'm fine with leaving the table that is previous in the findings where we have to show the changes in population and employment capacity. But we're not downzoning from 5400A to 9600. The change is from 5400A LID to 9600. And so under the LID regulations, they weren't really able to develop at all. And so that's why, so I think it's important to remember that we're changing from a zone that's 5400 LID, okay? And that is a completely different beast than just 5400A. So that's why I suggest the language in blue. I removed that, the second sentence that struck there, one of the planning goals is property rights and avoiding arbitrary and discriminatory actions, because we say it in the paragraph ahead, I mean before that, so this is just repetitive. And in blue, you see I added the RCW citation, so it streamlines it. And then I say instead of recognizing downzoning, I say instead, and this is what I would like the language to read. However, it is also appropriate to recognize that previous regulations under Ordinance 1988 were complicated and difficult to administer, thereby preventing development and causing hardship upon some property owners. This comprehensive plan amendment is designed to apply updated best available science and development standards while providing additional development flexibility to achieve both environmental protection and respect property rights.
Okay. Who would like to weigh in on this one first? Councilmember Spivey?
Great. I do not support the strikeout and the addition of this language. I think it's an opinion whether this is considered a down zone or not. And again, I think this is trying to rewrite the history of what has happened there. I believe that it is a down zone, even though it is a 5400 ALID. I still think it is a down zone, and I think that needs to be recognized. And so I do not support this change that's presented.
Councilmember Agnew?
I'd be in support of writing in the GMA's goals under that RCW, but as far as the other, I think it's, we really don't need to bring up Ordinance 1988 as far as I'm concerned ever again.
Councilmember Neal?
I'm in support of including the RCW above, and I would like clarification from staff on the rewording of this and how it has, what effects it would have before I can give my supporter.
Well, of course, this is a council finding, and basically what the idea is, the findings are kind of supposed to be the council's, you know, basically statement of why they have made these changes. Again, we don't want to be mandating to the council what they write, but I mean, I think that some kind of form here is probably fine. I mean, it's your findings. I don't want to overemphasize that too much, but what you guys feel comfortable with is what we would suggest you do. Anything else?
Bruce, can you clarify something for me? Because you said findings.
Yes.
The first discussion we had on P78, finding number 14. So we're saying that our finding is that, and I'm sorry I'm going back to this, but I just want to make sure I'm clarifying something here. We're, as a council, we're saying that based on testimony and soil excavation descriptions provided by the public, indicated near surface groundwater is not prevalent. We're saying that's our finding?
Actually, yes, that is one of the findings you're making by putting that thing. It's basically a parametrics statement, but by putting that into your findings, you're basically agreeing with that.
We're agreeing with parametrics.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for that clarification.
Yes.
I'm in support of leaving the language as is in that lower section.
Mayor Rayum, do you want to weigh in?
Yeah, I'll weigh in. I like Councilmember Sandberg's changes. I don't really consider this a down zone in any way, shape, or form. You know, the whole reason why we went back and tried to I'm not excited about putting Ordinance 1988 in there because it's basically stricken from the record by the Growth Management Hearing Board. But the rest of it, I think, does make sense that, you know, we went from R40,000 to, I can't remember, there was an interim zoning, and then we went to R5400A, which was basically undevelopable. Like, you could not figure out that code to figure out what you could do with your land. And so I don't consider us going to 9600 being a down zone.
Okay, Councilmember Sandberg.
Point of clarification. Ordinance 2163 is the one that is invalidated by the Growth Management Hearings Board and really doesn't appear in our findings. But Ordinance 1988 is referenced by staff multiple locations in our findings. So when we say we don't ever want to hear Ordinance 1988 again, that is the ordinance under which our current plan and code amendments are under effect right now. So it's 2163 is the one that we want to forget, not 1988. So I wasn't trying to drag up old history. It's exactly what staff has told us.
Okay. So I guess I'm the last to weigh in.
My bad.
Sorry?
I take it back. I thought that was the ordinance number 2163 was the one that got repealed. So 1988 is fine.
Okay. So I'm the last to weigh in. I'm in support of the language that Councilmember Sandberg has added. So if I add correctly, are we tied? We're tied.
Yeah, but I think there's a clarification there for 1988 to 2163. So knowing that 1988 is the actual one we're at mm-hmm. now, I'm in support of that language.
Okay.
But I thought this was something different.
Okay, great. Okay, so do you have that, Bruce? So there are four for changing the language?
Thank you.
Okay. Councilmember Sandberg, number three.
Number three, just a slight word change. So this is on page 90, and it reads, the current language reads, despite these impacts, the reach of North Creek within the sub-area is considered to have a moderate to high level of ecological function, the highest ecological function assigned within the city of Bothell. I just changed it to adding a comma, and instead of saying ecological function twice, just say the highest designation assigned within the city of Bothell.
Okay. Anyone want to weigh in on that? Everyone good with that change? Mayor? I guess he's fine with it. Okay.
Moving sorry, on. I had to open up my phone. I can't see it, so I don't really know.
Do you want me to read it?
Is it a big deal or not? I can't.
I'll read it. So she's changing ecological function to designation, and I'll read the sentence. Despite these impacts, the reach of North Creek within this subarea is considered to have a moderate to high level of ecological function, the highest designation assigned within the city of Bothell, rather than high level of ecological function, the highest ecological function within. It's just a clarification, I think. Does that make sense?
Can we have staff weigh in on that? I don't see what the point. What, or maybe Councilmember Sandberg could elaborate on what the point is to change that.
It's just grammar and readability. We say ecological function twice within the span of four words.
Certainly staff yeah. doesn't have any problem with it. It's a grammatical correction.
Great. Okay. Number four.
Okay, I'm okay with it.
Okay. Number four.
So this deals with the conversation that we had last time about this additional clause, and which are located in areas with soils with high rate of infiltration. So remember, this is language that only applies to the NCPA. We're not talking about zone one. And the language reads, protect the quantity and quality of groundwater inputs into palm woods and coal creeks. Implementing regulations, and I thought we had talked about changing that should to a shall. I thought we'd had that conversation, but anyway, it says, implementing regulations should include provisions requiring all development activities within the palm and coal woods creek sub-basins, which may affect groundwater and which are located in areas with soils with high rate of infiltration. It requires those development activities to follow this laundry list of things. And I argued last time that the and that is between may affect groundwater and soils with high rate of infiltration is very important, because according to this wording, all of those subsequent protections that follow at the end of that sentence, they are only required when both conditions exist, when there is activities that affect groundwater and when you have high rate of infiltration. So how is high rate defined? It's not defined, and I think that's what the mayor was speaking about last week. When we retain this infiltration clause, this additional and requirement, in my opinion, it creates more loopholes and provides less protection to the area that Parametrics has deemed important. So staff responded to this request, but they didn't, I don't think they identified the harm in removing the clause. Whereas I think if we retain that clause and we require this and this to trigger those protections, we're potentially creating more harm in those areas. So I, again, like I did the last time on the 13th, I'm asking that we strike the clause that has, and which are located in areas with soils with a high rate of infiltration.
Would staff like to weigh in on that before we go around?
Thank you. Yes, this is Bruce Blackburn. I've been speaking with the director, and again, the North Creek Protection Area is intended to be a really pretty high level of protection area. This was language, the and which are located in areas with soils with high infiltration. That was language recommended by Parametrics. I think that it's probably okay to remove that language because, again, we're applying very high standards to the NCPA, and this is kind of the foundation for those high standards. And again, the regulations have got the very similar protections of what we've had in Ordinance 1980. I think it's okay to remove it.
Okay. How does everyone feel? Is everyone okay with removing that? Councilmember Spivey?
I'm okay with that as long as this does not affect Zone 1. As long as it doesn't affect Zone 1, I'm okay with it. If it affects Zone 1, then...
And this does not affect Zone 1.
Okay.
Mayor, you want to weigh in? Are you okay?
We're talking about findings anyways, and I'm okay to remove it.
Okay.
It has no bearing on the actual technical evaluation of a site, whether or not you're going to infiltrate. So taking it out probably makes a lot of sense.
Okay, great.
And we're going to add the word shall as well.
Yes, we're adding the word shall instead of should. Okay, number five, Councilmember Sandberg.
Okay, here we're getting into code language, actual code language. This is back to the special submittal requirements, and we were talking about adding a additional requirement or letter under the special site studies, and we talked about this last time as well. So in the first paragraph, I think that we should just change the word from submit to contain, because applications don't submit things. Applicants submit things, but applications contain things. So it should read applications contain the following special studies, but that's a minor word change. The real change is in letter F. And so staff had proposed that when we're talking about special site studies, this is on page 117. If you remember some of the special submittal requirements, currently A through E are things like topography, soil type, wetlands and critical areas. F was added by staff, groundwater evaluation as required by the BOFL surface water manual. And I'm concerned about that language because when you look at what the BOFL surface water manual says about groundwater, it says that it will be adopting the 2016 King County Surface Water Design Manual. And when you look at the 2016 King County Surface Water Design Manual, it doesn't require groundwater studies except to do, and what I've written here, first percolation testing and two other references to groundwater. One in using liners and ditches when surface water might contaminate groundwater, and then one instance where you have to direct shallow groundwater to ditches if encountered. So the takeaway message is that the 2016 King County Surface Water Design Manual is not designed to protect groundwater. It's simply an engineering manual focused on mitigating surface water created during storm events. So I don't think what the staff recommended language is we're referencing a document that references another document, which really doesn't have any information or requirements about groundwater. It's a stormwater manual. And so What I have suggested is instead of it saying F reading groundwater as required, groundwater evaluation as required by the Bothell Surface Water Manual, it's to say groundwater evaluation to determine approximate depth and location. And the point again, which I said again, I said on the 13th, is not to use this as a means to prevent development. It is to identify it and then use that to inform site development to the maximum extent permissible or possible. Okay, it's not to prevent development. We've all recognized that we don't have the resources to go out and dig test pits all over the place to really characterize where groundwater is. Experts, everybody's gone up and said groundwater exists. So in the development process, when developers are digging their test pits, which they do anyway for geotechnical evaluation, they include information about groundwater evaluation. There's nothing here that says they have to, you know, do a certain number of test pits. It's a general evaluation that they will be using anyway because they need to determine where to locate their stormwater facilities. And groundwater is an important part of that. And I think it's clearer to state it the way I've suggested rather than reference a manual that references another manual that really doesn't have anything to do with groundwater resources.
Okay. Mayor, how about you weigh in on this first?
Okay. So it's very common for a city to reference a manual and then have a local adoption manual that you adopt. So the state requires us to adopt a manual locally, and if you adopt the King County manual or the ecology manual, there's a State Department of Ecology manual, you have to have a local manual that you adopt, that the King County or the ecology manual. So it's very common to have that. Now I'm a little bit shocked. Gotta be honest with you, I have not gone through the King County manual verbatim, but I know per state law and federal law that it has to have an equivalent level of groundwater protection as the state manual does. So the King County manual has to have something in there that talks about groundwater, because you can't take stormwater and try to infiltrate it into the ground if the groundwater is right there. It won't go into the ground. So there's got to be something. That's why in previous meetings I've tried to say, whatever it says in the King County manual, make sure that's part of the record, because I know there has to be engineering specifics about what you can put into the ground and where you can put it, how much separation your stormwater facility has from the groundwater, so A, you don't contaminate it, and B, that the stormwater can become groundwater. So I don't know what Councilmember Sandberg searched through or not, and I have to be honest with you, I have not tried to get crack open the King County manual, but it has to, per state law, protect groundwater, and it has to manage stormwater to the federal and state standards, and so it should be fine. I don't know if staff has anything they have looked at, talked to Public Works, stormwater engineers, or anything like that. But it'd be nice to know if the King County manual doesn't say anything, I would be totally shocked, because it's a state law. You cannot contaminate groundwater with stormwater, and you can't build a stormwater system that infiltrates if the groundwater is right there.
Okay. Mr. Blackburn's at the podium. I think he has something to add.
I do. Yes. Thank you very much. The King County manual, which the city will be adopting as its own manual, in fact, that's going to be integrated into our Bothell design and construction standards, does have language about determining groundwater information within it. It is part of the TIR, technical information report, that has to be gathered as part of any surface water design type of an approach. However, having said that, I don't think we have a real issue if we have something that says groundwater testing data is one of the information provisions you supply, because the testing data will tell you the depth of the groundwater and where it was higher or lower and the effects of, because we do know that they will have to provide some form of data on groundwater as part of their surface water manual provisions. So if we could offer an alternative, it'd be groundwater testing data would be one of the things that would be submitted.
So you'd say, it would say, F would say groundwater testing data?
Yes.
I'm fine with that.
So strike evaluation and the rest and just say groundwater testing data?
Yes.
Okay. Is everyone okay with that? Councilmember Spivey?
I'm not in support of that. I'm going with the mayor on this, that the King County is going to have, you know, their manual is going to protect the groundwater from stormwater. And the more we narrow in our focus outside of that manual means that when things change, we're just going to have to come back and change it so that it keeps up. If we keep it to the manual, then as that manual changes, it automatically changes. We don't have to update it because our reference is the manual. But if we get too narrow, then we're always going to have to update and readdress these issues. So by keeping it to that, you know, our manual is referenced to the King County manual, it's cleaner for us. It provides, it ends up doing less work. And as time goes on, has the highest level of protection. And we don't have to readdress it. It's already addressed here.
Go ahead, Bruce.
Actually, that's a valid point because we have had that issue in the past that we've had something we've put into the code and then we've had to update it. However, there is some additional information we could offer, and that would be evaluation of applicable groundwater standards. Make that part of the submittal requirement so that basically whatever is within this King County manual has to be provided as part of the packet that is provided to the city.
So, and again, that goes back to, that's part of what King County is requiring. And it's something we wouldn't have to constantly update. So if you're just saying, provide the data that King County requires, which I think we're saying that anyway.
We kind of are, yes.
Yeah, we're being redundant. So I think by keeping it clean.
A clarifying question? So we haven't adopted it yet, though, correct?
No, it is imminent.
It's imminent, but
I think it's the 30th.
Okay.
December 30th.
Oh, okay, so it is imminent. Okay, so right now we have a suggestion of applicable groundwater standards, and Councilmember Spivey.
Deputy Mayor, can I?
Yes, please.
I'm sorry, can I chime in? I'm double dipping here.
Yes.
Council, okay with me taking a second swing? What I hope we're not trying to do is to create an additional requirement for groundwater evaluation for these 40 acres. Because what I've been trying to say in other meetings is that what the King County manual requires is prescribed by state and federal law. It is considered the best, it's considered reasonable, all known, what's it called? All known ACARD. Sorry, I forget the acronym. But anyways, it is exactly what we should be requiring of those 40 acres to evaluate their groundwater. I don't think we want those 40 acres to have some other special study done of the groundwater system on that hill compared to the rest of the city. So if Councilmember Sandberg, if the change that you're looking to do would make it so there's this special groundwater study that needs to be done for those 40 acres, I'm not exactly in support of that. Or if we're talking about the whole NCIT, it seems to me to be rather, it really confuses things when you're trying to evaluate what you can or can't do with your stormwater management. If you've got a groundwater study you need to perform compared to just anywhere else in the city. So in my opinion, I know actually by federal and state law, we're already being required to make people evaluate their stormwater. I'm sorry, their groundwater. So why don't we just use what is the industry standard in this area versus the rest of the city and not make it some special different groundwater study?
Okay.
Okay.
Councilmember Sandberg.
My intent is not to make it something different and special. I was fine with staff's suggestion that we change it to groundwater testing data. This is what they do as a part of site investigation anyway. I stand by my assertion that the King County Surface Water Design Manual doesn't require groundwater studies beyond the three things that I mentioned, which is what the mayor says in terms of keeping surface water that is potentially contaminated out of the groundwater, which is what I've highlighted for you in items 2 and 3. So I remain concerned that we're relying on manuals that are not designed to evaluate groundwater location on the site. So I was fine with the staff suggestion that we change that to groundwater testing data.
We got a second swipe at it, though, to change it to applicable groundwater standards. Are you okay with that? Because that was their latest suggestion.
I don't think we have a clear handle on what applicable groundwater standards are. That's why I liked the original, their original suggestion. Groundwater testing data.
Bruce, I have a clarifying question. So I think Councilmember Sandberg's original statement was depth and location. Isn't there much more to than just depth and location? Isn't there flow, volume, you know, several different things that they look for during that testing process?
Yeah, and actually, and I'm sorry, when Councilmember Sandberg identified that there are some trigger points in the manual that say, oh, look, hey, you got to do more information, you got to provide more information. If you have a situation where you're not going to affect the groundwater flow or anything like that, you don't necessarily have to provide a lot of detailed information. That was one of the reasons why we like kind of applying it, you know, using the surface water manual that we're going to be implementing here in 3 days. I guess maybe to go to our second suggestion, evaluation of applicable groundwater standards. If it's not applicable, then you don't have to do it. And that's kind of why the term applicable is there. But depth and location, the key will be depth, because as we know, there is groundwater in this area, in zone one area. It just depends upon how deep it is, if you're going to have an effect or not. You know, I'm thinking about this testing data language. That might get us into a slippery slope. What do you think?
Hi, Council. Tom Burdett. In evaluating the criteria under A, B, C, D, and E, underneath a special site study which describes the natural process existing on the land and around the site, and the applicant may include information of site maps and reports, you know, it makes sense to me to identify applicable groundwater standards. So whatever standard the city adopts, that's what needs to be incorporated in the supplemental study that comes in with the application. You may be limiting yourself somewhat by using the words of that we actually coined of testing the groundwater, but the application of the standards is probably where we're ultimately going to end up.
Clear as mud? So staff's recommending the language of evaluation of applicable groundwater standards, is that correct?
Yes. Okay. Yes, sorry.
So, is everyone okay with that? No? Yes, yes, yes.
Just a question. How is that different than just going with the King County manual?
Well, it's in construction of code language, it's important so that you don't constantly have to update your code when there's a new title that comes out in a stormwater manual and it's not consistent with the local code, this language is used as a way to allow for the newer code, the newer manual to be used without citing it specifically.
But
it's good code writing practice.
But when we reference all of the King County manual, isn't that the same thing?
For now it is, but.
But when King County.
10 years from now, it may not.
But it's still the King County manual, right?
A future council may want to adopt the ecology manual, for example.
But they would still have to make the change.
Well, if
either way, the change is going to be made to adopt it.
That's true, but you'd only have to change it in one spot instead of multiple spots in the code.
Seems like when you have the King County manual and then this language you're proposing, you're having to change two things throughout the code anyway.
We don't see it that way.
Councilmember Spivey, can you just weigh in, yes or no?
Well, I would like to, I want to, but I'm trying to educate myself so I can.
Tom, can you explain to him how, because I think I understand what you're trying to say, but maybe explain to him that the manual, so the different councils can have different things they adopt, but the language in which you're suggesting actually applies to any of the different.
Yes, exactly. That's
regardless of the name, you don't have to update it in this location.
Standards, applicable is kind of the action verb there.
But couldn't somebody choose what is applicable if you don't spell it out? I mean,
no.
Because you say King County manual, but, well, you know, I'm going to adopt the state manual. I want to use the state manual instead in King County. That's where.
No, generally not.
It's only the only thing that's applicable is that which the city has adopted as being applicable to a project development.
Okay. Well, then I'll reluctantly go with staff's recommendation.
Mayor. Do you want to weigh in? I think we have four.
I'm okay with staff recommendation. Just do not reference the King County manual. Make sure it's the Bothell Surface Water Design Manual so that if we do decide to go with the ecology manual in the future, you don't have to go back and change this section of code. We're currently in the ecology manual. We are switching to the King County manual. There's no code changes necessary to do so because everything in the code references the Bothell Surface Water Design Manual.
Okay. Shoo. On to number six, Councilmember Sandberg.
So as clarification, what council is adopting is F to read evaluation of applicable groundwater standards. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. So number six is a little bit bigger issue. Here we were talking about allowing stormwater vaults because it appeared as though stormwater vaults were prohibited in the Fitzgerald subarea in both the NCPA and in Zone 1. And so I believe staff made the attempt to recognize that vaults would be permitted. But I'm concerned here with the staff's suggested language change and location. I don't think it accomplished what we had discussed. So this is on page 122 and 123 of the agenda packet. It's in section 1252.040, which are special regulations applying to the Zone 1 area. And it's in the subsection C of open space and forest preservation. So staff added language to 3.2, C3II. And so I'm concerned that number one, it looks as though stormwater vaults have now received higher prioritization over rehabilitated or restored forest areas and lands adjacent to critical area buffers. Because it does say in the preamble statement that applicants will follow this hierarchy of 1, 2, 3, and 4, and now we've inserted vaults into 2 above 3 and 4, which I don't support. And I think that we had had language about, or we had had discussion about, you know, vaults when no other stormwater facility option exists, they should be able to use vaults, but we don't want them to be removing trees in the process to dig the big hole to put the stormwater vault in. So I was looking for where we would put the language that allows the installation of vaults down on the bottom of the hierarchy list. And I am thinking it should go instead on page 118, which is under 12, section 12.52.020.C1G. And if that isn't confusing, I don't know what is. But I think here is where we would clarify that vaults are not prohibited when the options higher up in the hierarchy are exhausted. So I guess I would like staff's comment on that in terms of finding a place in the code to say that vaults are permitted down the hierarchy. And I just don't think this is the appropriate area. And I think that the original language is something that we should stay with. So the original language is what there is in what I've written in blue. And that was the language from the 12-13 version, which reads, for the purposes of credit toward preservation of open space, stormwater vaults or other closed or underground systems shall not be considered forest equivalent surface water facilities. Because I think that's true. Stormwater vaults are not considered forest equivalent surface water facilities. And if I read the PUD language, they can't use stormwater facilities to count towards their open space either in the PUD language that you provided.
That's correct. It actually, if you'll look at the screen, we actually have a rewrite of this section. Now remember, this section that I'm pulling up is about the clustering provisions. And when we have our open space that is created through the clustering provision, what type of land, and it's in yellow highlight, it's A3, that would be the preference for those open space areas. And of course, the first would be certainly intact forest areas that we've already identified, or lands containing forest equivalent bioretention surface water facilities or intact forest areas that accept dispersed surface water. Again, the idea behind it is that is the more natural look. I've got a little bit of a screenshot here of what a bioretention facility is. Basically, it's a shallow, not quite a pond, but basically a shallow depression in which you put your surface water. The third preference would be rehabilitated or forest areas within those open space created areas. The final wouldn't be, the fourth would be lands adjacent to critical area buffers. And then number 5 would be lands containing other types of forest equivalent surface water facilities. Now, one of the things about it is that a surface water facility can be considered forest equivalent if it has a high enough, basically, retention and a low enough release rate. And that's basically what the manual is identifying. And then those type of facilities would only be allowed within open spaces if they provided for the recreational facilities that we talked about at our last meeting that we identified, okay, something like a sport court or an open lawn area or some other kind of a playground or something like that. So that would kind of reorder that hierarchy a little bit so that we basically said within the lands that are created for open space through our clustering provision, the vaults that are being placed within an open space would be the last priority preferred item.
Thank you for that change. Can we say anything where in 5 that the vaults, installation of the vaults should not remove forest area or cover? Because what we're trying to do is use clustering to preserve forest area and intact forests and trees. And if we allow the installation of a vault that takes out that, then we're counterproductive towards the overall goal.
That's harder, specifically because this is for the zone one area, this language here. And the concept there would be that you'd have to get to the very end of the preferences before you could do something like that. I suppose what you could identify, you could add a little bit more language in here that says something along the lines of, even more emphasis placed upon this, don't put surface water vaults within intact forest areas or something like that. I think the language is pretty good because we're very clear that we're identifying that intact forest areas or forest equivalent bioretention or rehabilitated forest areas or lands next to critical area buffers, and then finally the vault type of a concept you were talking about. And again, the only ways you could put a vault within your open space is if it was served some type of a recreation function. And that was one of the other areas we talked a little bit about when we were talking about the clustering mechanism, is in some locations it makes some sense to have some recreational facilities there. So there you go.
All right. Well, I support your change. Thank you.
Can I ask a clarifying question? So this is for zone one.
Zone one, yes.
For NICPA, do we have to, I guess we don't have to worry about it because we're not preserving open space per se through the clustering mechanism, correct?
Well, that's correct. And the other thing is, too, within the NICPA, we are actually having a forest preservation requirement of 60%.
Right, 60%. Okay.
Yeah, so that's a given. That is a fixed.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure. Okay. Is everyone okay with that change? Yes, yes, yes. Mayor? He fell asleep.
Yep, I'm fine.
Okay, moving on.
Okay, number seven. Which means we're almost to number eight. This is also something that I brought up last time. I see that, so this is, it's called site design regulations, and it's a section that says that you have to consider the information that you gathered in all the special site studies. And I asked that this be added to zone one, and I don't see where it was added because we have this clause in the NCPA, which is you do all these special studies and then lots of other things in the NCPA, and then you have to use that information to inform your site design. I don't see how we have that anywhere. So this is for NCPA. I don't see how we have that anywhere in zone one. They collect all the information for the special studies, but they're not required to do anything. And I'd ask that be added somewhere. And so I'm suggesting that we add this exact language. It's identical staff language that applies to the NCPA. Add this as section D to 1252.040, which is on the top of page 123. But if I have that wrong and staff wants to point me to the citation in our code where we have that parallel language, I'm open to that.
And Council Member Sandberg is correct. That was not applied to the Zone 1 areas. And I, if I got this incorrect last week, I apologize. I didn't think we had consensus to apply this to the Zone 1 areas as well as the North Creek Protection Area. But, this is the Council's opportunity to say, look, we want this applied to Zone 1 as well.
So my question is, then why would we have them conduct all those studies, the A through E, now F, if we don't?
Well, it's part of the information that's provided, and that basically gets you that background data. It's the site assessment that's so important to understanding how the project works. And you don't necessarily have to say, look, and then you have to design it to that provision standard, because the you know for sure they're going to do that, because as they set their stormwater, they set their open space areas, they set their forest preservation areas, they've got to take that information into account. It's as much a tool for the developer as it is for the city.
Well, I guess I don't see why we wouldn't say that your site design shall consider the information that you've already gathered. I don't know why we wouldn't say that. In any instance, not just NCPA and Zone 1, I mean, anywhere in the city, if we're going to require that the applicant gather information, I would figure that they would have something that says they have to use that in their site design.
So, Bruce, can you clarify once a developer brings that information in, what's the process after that?
Well, essentially what happens is staff uses that to evaluate the project. And it's not just the Fitzgerald regulations that we have to apply. It's also the critical area regulations. It's the site design provisions. There's a bunch of site design provisions underneath the Bothell Municipal Code, citywide Bothell Municipal Code under 1214. That we use as well. And there is some topographic modification provisions within those areas. So this is going to be really important information for us to have in one document that we can actually look at, particularly the wildlife information. That'll be important as well. So all those things are taken into consideration as we evaluate, and hopefully the applicant has done that. And that's the purpose of this. Say, okay, applicant, engineer, designers, here's your site. Now you got to design it to comply with those parameters you have on your piece of property.
So you don't think this is necessary, this particular paragraph?
I didn't think it was necessary, but I may be hearing something different from the council, so please correct me.
Councilmember Neal?
If we add that this language here, would that be different from what we have in all other parts of Bothell?
It is. It would be a little bit different.
So I think just understanding development and how it works and how these reports and the testing is actually applied in principle when a developer goes out and does them and then submits them. For me, I think what I'm reading, I don't understand what happens after that. But I understand it because I'm in the industry. But I think people who don't understand it, they submit these reports. You guys, you know, review the reports, and then that they have to design to those specifics, what's allowable, based on the manuals and the different things, the codes and things. So I understand it, but I think the language doesn't really say that, yeah, that's what the city goes through after they submit.
Okay, let me think about this for a minute. Go on to your next item.
Is there a next item?
The next item, I think, is easy. So this is in the changes to the PUD language, Chapter 1230. On the bottom of page 167, it says there are three types of PUDs established. And then after that, we've added number 4. Which is the Fitzgerald clustering subdivision, clustering PUD. So that should read not three types of PUDs, but 4 types of PUDs.
Seems pretty straightforward.
Really good.
Yeah. Anyone have a problem with that? Okay.
I don't have that on my sheet that you handed out, so.
Oh, it's on page 169 of your packet.
If all it is just adding the 4th PUD, then I'm fine with that.
It changes the word 3 to 4.
But going back to the last one.
Yeah, sure, weigh in.
I'm comfortable with just the way it is. I do not want to create any environment that heads us back in the direction that got us here in the first place. I don't want the sense of a complicated you know, if somebody comes in here, they buy a property, or they're looking at buying a property, and they look at all this, and they look at it and go, it's too complicated, I'm out. I don't want us to get there. I want to keep this clean and neat and as simple as possible. And sometimes I think when by adding too many words, we complicate and we start to make it seem more difficult than it really is. James is pointing out, he understands this. He knows what's going on. He's a developer. Developers will understand with this without the extra verbiage. So I think it's unnecessary to have it. And staff knows what to do with this lane, what to do with those studies. So I think keeping it clean is the best thing we can do, and just leave it the way it is.
Can I ask a question? It's related. I guess the question is whether or not it's obvious that you do studies and you do something with them. If they're made to do the studies, isn't it implied that they'll be used for decision making?
Well,
or
yeah.
Not?
Yes, in fact, you know, architects, landscape architects, engineers all know that you get your information about your site, and that informs your design, and that's just basic, almost engineering 102, actually it's probably 204 now. But the idea is that is part of your professional credentials, if it would, to say, look, yeah, we're going to take this information. Now we know what this site is about. Now we can design it appropriately, particularly with the new surface water design manuals. There's going to be such an emphasis on how you treat your surface water as it goes off the site. If you don't have this information and you ignore this information, you're going to fail when you do your modeling for that hydrology on the site.
Well, and further, for me, you know, if we add it here, then do we need to go and add it everywhere else, I guess is the question.
Well, yeah,
right?
Maybe you looked at that kind of a approach, yes.
Okay, so Della's not for... Wait, let's weigh in.
Okay.
Who is for changing the language as proposed?
On the last.
On the last. On number seven. Yes, no, 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 no. Okay. So with that, we're done with Councilmember Sandberg's input. Who would like to weigh in next with any questions or changes? Councilmember McNeil.
First, I'd like to thank Councilmember Sandberg for her thoroughness in bringing all this up and wordsmithing things. It has been a long process. I haven't been involved in this process nearly as long as some of the other council members, city staff, and members of the community. But I will tell you that I made many appointments. I met with many folks in the community. I met with both the property owners and SAVE. I've digested all of the information presented, and I feel very confident in the decision that I'm going to make tonight that it's very well vested. And I think that's what the community asks of us council members, is to make sure that we're well informed when we make the decisions. And I just want the community to know that several of the council members up here have spent numerous hours reviewing and meeting and discussing. And I want to thank all of them as well for taking the time to do this on this very important piece of legislation. So I want to thank my colleagues up here. I want to thank the city staff for all their hard work on this, as well as members of the community and SAVE as well for bringing all this information to us so that we can make this decision tonight. Thank you.
Any other comments? Council members Bybee?
I just want to thank everybody for, you know, everything they put into this, the effort that's gone into it, and to the public for their patience. Other than that, unless you have a comment, I would. All right, then I have a motion as soon as you're done.
Can I add a little bit real quick?
Absolutely.
I can speak to the motion too. Go ahead, Councilor Spivey.
He's going to wait till you and I weigh in or with our comments.
Okay. So I just wanted to take a walk down history lane here real quick and talk about the infamous Ordinance 2163. And I was on the council it was one of the few times I actually spoke out in opposition to the council. What it did, it took all the environmental protections for the entire Big Fuchapa or the Fitzgerald area, and it took every shall and it changed it to should. And in code world, that means basically you might as well have deleted the entire thing. And the Growth Management Hearing Board came back and said, you know what, this is wrong, and we want you to fix it. And we spent a lot of money. We almost went to court at Thurston County to try to defend it, and we had a change in the council. And at the end of the day, to me, what really happened was that, you know, I personally did not want to try to defend Ordinance 2163 because I thought it was wrong. And we've approached this new version of what to do with this area, which is a SAGIF this has been going on for 20 years, and I feel very bad for the property owners that have been trying to sell their property. I visited those properties, and I saw the area, and I said, well, where does this drain to? You know, and they showed me, and lo and behold, you know, there's nothing like somebody that works the land that can tell you exactly what's going on. And they were dead on about where that water drained to. And, you know, it became very evident and clear to me that we needed to do something, not for the entire area. There's definitely, you know, we have a lot of wetland complexes that are important and healthy, and we wanted to protect those. But at the same time, why was that hill ever brought into this thing is beyond me. It really is. And I think we're doing the right thing today, hopefully. At least I am in support of bifurcating, which is a really fun word, that hill out of this scenario, because I don't think it ever should have been part of it. And what we're doing as a council is we're trying to protect the environment while protecting the rights of property owners in the area. And I think we've struck a balance that is head and shoulders above what Ordinance 2163 was. I think it's head and shoulders above Ordinance 1988, because you couldn't do anything with your land under Ordinance 1988. And so I hope the council supports that we make these changes tonight. I think this has gone on long enough. I think that, you know, we heard some public testimony tonight that let's drag this into 2017. And quite frankly, I'm tired of it. I think we have gone over this thing as far as I'm willing to go. I hope that we don't end up in court, but if we do, so what? Because I really honestly feel in the bottom of my heart, we have done the right thing for this area. And if we end up going that route where we gotta defend it, so be it. I really do feel like both 1988 and 2163 were not good ordinances. I feel like we have done our homework on this one, and I hope that it holds.
Thank you.
That's it.
I just want to say it's been a really long and difficult process that began in January with the council voting to end the appeal. And although it's been a difficult year at revisiting this area, I still believe it was the right decision for the environment and the right decision for Bothell. Since we began this journey this year, I have been committed to finding a balanced solution that would still protect the environment but allow for clearer guidelines for development. And I believe we've found a good compromise, because I believe our decision to remove Zone 1 is based on facts that say that its groundwater is not impacting Coal Creek and Palm Creek and the critical salmon habitat that those creeks provide. Would it be better for the environment to leave the current ordinance in place? Absolutely. But it would be better for the environment if we didn't develop at all. And due to the urban growth boundary, it was put in place to prevent sprawl and thereby protecting the environment from inefficient development. This necessitates that these communities within the urban growth boundary do their best to accommodate growth and to quote our natural element goal NEG1 of the Bothell comp plan, achieve harmonious relationship between the built and the natural environment. And I believe with all my heart that that's what we've tried to do in this process, and that's all you can ask of us is just to do our best, and I think we put in our hours and blood, sweat, and tears. So with that, Councilmember Spivey.
Yeah, I just wanted to move to close the public hearing.
Second.
Motion by Councilmembers Fivey, seconded by Councilmember Agnew. Motion passes unanimously with Councilmember Freed absent and excused, and Council or Mayor Rahim on the phone.
Oh, I approved that. Sorry, I lost you there for a second.
Oh, okay. Okay, so it passes unanimously. Would you like to make a motion, Councilmember Spivey?
Sure. I move the recommended action with the changes that were made tonight. Also, with the to consider the buffers as part of the final average lot calculations.
Is there a second? Sandberg.
I make a motion that we approve the 2016 plan and code amendments that include the Williamson plan amendments, the college campus plan and code amendments, and the Fitzgerald and Canyon Creek plan and code amendments as amended this evening, and giving staff the ability to make Scrivener edits to maintain consistency among the three individual findings.
Second.
Motion made by Councilmember Sandberg. I'm not going to repeat it. For comp plan updates in 2016, as stated, and seconded by, who was it? Councilmember Agnew. Please place your vote. Oh, okay. Councilmember Spivey.
Yeah, I'd like to make an amending motion to have zone one listed as R8400.
Is there a second? No. Councilmember Sandberg.
I'd like to speak to the motion and say that I'm supporting this because I think that there were several good things put in place. So I didn't get everything that I asked for. But I think the changes that were made, I appreciate council agreeing to them, and I hope that this iteration is the one that achieves the kind of balance that we're looking for.
Can we vote now?
Is anybody else going to speak?
Could you say what the, so there was an amending motion. It was broken up. I couldn't hear it.
Council Member Spivey made a motion to change the zone one to R8400, and there was no second.
And there was a second or no second?
No second.
Unless you want to make the second.
Shall we move on?
No, okay, not making a second. I haven't heard from any property owner that wanted to change it to 8400.
Okay. So back to the...
I haven't spoke to the motion.
Okay, go ahead.
So unless somebody else wants to go. I will support this motion. This has been a, as has been mentioned, a very long time coming. They actually, approximately 11 and a half months ago, this would have been settled. We would have gone and had an appeal, and it would have been decided, and it would have been done. We would have saved a lot of staff time, council time, public time, as well as money. Earlier today, one of our staff members in making the presentation listed several of the planning goals for the GMA. And one of them that wasn't listed in there, that he didn't list, was housing. And I'll read that one. Housing, number four, encourage the availability of affordable housing to all economic segments of the population of this state, promote a variety of residential densities and housing types, and encourage preservation of existing housing stock. I think by, first off, by approving this, we are adding to that housing. This is an area that people want to move to. I'm disappointed that we're not able to provide a higher level of housing and more likely a higher level of affordable housing. I think what we're going to find here is we're just going to end up with near million-dollar homes as opposed to affordable housing. So that's my disappointment here. I want to thank the people in Zone 1 for their patience. It's been a long time coming, but we're getting ready to cast a vote and hopefully put this thing to bed. So with that, I thank you all. And I thank my fellow council members for all their time and effort in this. We don't always agree, but we've had a pretty good conversation up here on this, and I thank you all for that.
Councilmember Agnew.
I'll be supporting the motion. This has been a long and arduous process, not as long for us as for some of the homeowners. And hopefully we made a promise to you that we'd get this done by the end of the year, and we're going to try to accomplish that goal. This is a he said, she said. You know, who do I believe? Do I believe this specialist or that specialist? I tend to believe the staff that we have. The staff is a very knowledgeable staff. They're very well-rounded. And they're trying to do the best. The zoning in this area has been inappropriate for two decades. Hopefully tonight we'll make that change.
I just wanted to say that although comments were sent today and not believed to have been looked at, they were looked at and questions were asked. I did ask the staff about the assertions that there's no best available science behind Parametrics report. And their comment to me was, see the appendix. And so that conversation leads me to believe that we have done what we need to do in regards to best available science. So with that, let's vote.
Deputy Mayor, I vote in the affirmative.
Okay, great, thanks. Motion passes unanimously with Councilmember Freed absent and excused.
Second.
Motion to adjourn by Councilmember McNeil, seconded by Councilmember Spivey.
I agree with that motion.
Thank you. I have a feeling it's unanimous. It's blank. Let's just raise our hands.
Aye.
I'm in favor. Okay. Vote passes unanimously with Councilmember Freed absent and excused. See you in 2017.